If you're a SpaceX fan, you will probably be familiar with classic shots like this. When it comes to spaceflight, rocket companies usually go above and beyond to document every aspect of their launches. Back in the Apollo days, TV stations covered the entire length of the Apollo 11 mission in great detail, reaching a viewership of 600 million people around the world when Neil Armstrong walked on the moon.
That's one small step for man.
The recent Falcon Heavy launch had over 1 million people watching live on YouTube alone. Thanks to the broadcast teams, we are able to watch these rockets go on their incredible journeys. But what about the rocket journeys we don't get to see? In this video, we are going to look at the challenging cross-country journey the Falcon 9 has to go through in order to reach the launch pad. We're also going to talk about the transportation methods that are used and the alternative methods that were used in the past. SpaceX manufactures the Falcon 9 rocket at their facility in Hawthorne, California, although the majority of their rockets launch from Cape Canaveral, Florida. This means they have to go through a 2,500-mile journey just to get to the launch site. In order to get to Cape Canaveral, the Falcon 9 travels in different parts on the back of a huge semi-truck. But even before that, every new Merlin engine is transported to their testing facility in McGregor, Texas, where it's put through a full static fire test. Each engine is then transported back to Hawthorne to be attached to the Falcon 9's first stage. Then the enormous first stage makes its long journey by road to Cape Canaveral, often stopping off in McGregor to perform static fire tests as a whole unit. The second stage fairings and each of the four landing legs are all transported to the Cape separately by truck. SpaceX typically contracts private hauling companies like Easy Trucking and Bayall Brothers to transport their Falcon 9 rockets using custom-built cradles fitted to a 44-wheeled trailer. The Falcon 9 parts are wrapped in a black fabric which protects them from any damage that could be sustained during the 2,500-mile drive. Once they reach the Cape, the Falcon 9 is unwrapped and checked before being handed over to SpaceX, who then transport the rocket to the assembly building on a vehicle they recently bought from NASA. This transporter was used to haul the space shuttle to the assembly building where it was attached to its boosters. Once the Falcon 9 is assembled in its hangar, the transporter erector moves it out to the launch pad horizontally and then raises it into its final position, ready for launch. Unlike most rockets, the Falcon 9's journey isn't over after it places its payload into orbit. Since SpaceX intend to reuse their rockets, more transportation is needed. When the Falcon 9 lands on the autonomous drone ship placed in the Atlantic Ocean, recovery vessels GoQuest and GoSearcher will typically be on standby with crew to secure the Falcon 9 to the drone ship and tow it back to the port at Cape Canaveral. So far, SpaceX has only been recovering the first stage of their rockets, and although this is the largest and most expensive part of the Falcon 9, SpaceX's long-term aim is to make rockets fully reusable. When SpaceX were designing the Falcon 9, the diameter of the rocket was limited to 3.7 meters, so that the rocket would fit under every bridge and overpass it would come across on its journey from California to Florida. This begs the question, why transport rockets by road? In the past, there have been many methods for transporting large rocket parts. Back in the 60s and 70s, NASA used a sea transport system to transport the massive Saturn V first stage to Florida. This involved a 10-day, 2,000-mile journey from Huntsville to Mississippi on the Tennessee River, and then all the way down the Mississippi River and round the south coast of Florida to Cape Kennedy, where the Saturn V was assembled and launched. Since the second stage was manufactured in California, it had to be transported by barge through the Panama Canal and back up to Florida. NASA used cargo planes to transport the third stage and the instrument unit to Cape Kennedy. Being only 6.5 meters in diameter, they were able to squeeze into a cargo aircraft aptly named Guppy, specifically designed for loads like this. Although sea transport was the main method of transporting the Saturn V, there were times when road transport was needed. This proved to be very challenging for the first and second stages, since they were 10 meters in diameter, a whole three times larger than the Falcon 9. Sea transit might have been the most practical transport method for the Saturn V simply because it was so big. But for rockets like the Falcon 9, shipping the parts this way is not very practical at all. Today, SpaceX keeps it simple by transporting nearly all of their rocket parts on land. Not only is this method the most practical for SpaceX, but it's also a lot cheaper than the alternative air and sea methods. So, there you have it. It turns out there is a lot more that goes on behind the scenes in transporting these incredibly large rocket parts all across the country. If you'd like to know more about what goes on behind the scenes of a rocket launch, check out my video on how rocket launches are filmed. If you have any questions, be sure to leave them in the comments below. And make sure you're subscribed so you can join the discussion as we continue to learn more about all things space. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.
Man, you are really bouncing. That max acceleration?
Is he on the ground at all?
He's at 10 kilometers.
He's got about two wheels on the ground. Come on back, John. Man, I'll tell you, Indy's never seen a driver like this.